So let me, I will not go through these. So let me tell you, I'll show you what's on here, you can read these on your own, and then we can use this to guide the conversation, and we can just start to, just jump into questions, and I can share stories, or, you know, whatever you want me to, or if you want me to go into, I'm happy to go into slides. So this is a slide that I've used before in the consulting class to show you at least my view of how I see consulting as being structured these days, the body of consulting, the five major types of firms, and the blends, smaller firms, including a smaller firm is defined as those less than 100 full-time consultants. And that includes those firms with one person, which when you incorporate it's their firm. 2016 was a great year for consulting, 2017 an even better year, but since it's not over, we don't have the numbers. Hottest areas on the vertical side, and verticals are industries. So it's like life sciences where I sit, healthcare is an industry, insurance, financial services industry for FSI, financial sector. You just got a job in financial?
I did.
Okay. And like some financial. So it's so that's the verticals. Horizontals are things that they're consulting services that move across industries like change management, organizational change management, organizational change design, strategy, right? Horizontals. So hottest air is the vertical side, healthcare, payer, provider, right? Life sciences continues that it's big. It's a big difference. I mean, it's a horse race where there's like 6 furlongs of difference between the next one. Within the healthcare segment, life sciences is strong momentum, mostly because of all the cool things that happen, and things happen really quickly in the life sciences segment. Really quickly for things happening very slow. So you may have read the paper 2 days ago. Otsuka Pharma in Princeton got approval from the FDA for the first digital pill. I actually worked on this project 4 years ago, and they got the approval 2 days ago.
Wow.
So that's not really an indication of how slow the government works in approvals, but it's how slow the government works in conjunction with industry, in conjunction with the patient population. It's a real cool story behind this, and I'm happy to share that. It's great consulting learnings to take out of it, and what happened during that 4 year period. Financial services makes strong. Energy vertical seems to be regaining its footing. It was really, really, really strong, and then it just fell off a cliff. And then it's really strong again. It's really coming back. In the horizontal side, mergers, acquisitions, divestitures, alliances. So there's a play here on the strategy side. You know, what type of things can you do to help a company figure out whether they should merge with another company or not merge or divest a portion of their portfolio. You can help them think it out from a process side. You can help them think through things from a technology side. So you see that a lot in mergers. Big company gobbles up a smaller company, or two companies of the same size, or a smaller company gobbles up a big company, which happens more often than you think. You got to bring not only your people together, but you got to bring your infrastructure together as well. And that technology merger is always challenging, always challenging. So there's a play across the board. And divestitures, you know, is what it is. And, you know, in some cases, companies have to divest themselves of a product or a service line or a portfolio, typically to get approval from SEC or somebody else to go forth. And alliances, you see this a lot in the life sciences industry, where the companies need pipeline, and they just, you know, they run out of ideas. So you will align. Most companies do alliances or acquisitions in order to buy pipeline, whether it's pharmaceutical drug pipeline or idea pipeline. So you see it a lot in Hollywood, right? In the media industry, the entertainment industry. See a lot of alliances. You know, we will work with you. You're a two-person company, but we want your screenplay or your scripts or your screenwriters. So we're going to create an alliance, which is a merger that's temporary, essentially. So these are really hot areas. Data in the cloud, strategy implementation, managed services, compliance-related consulting, It's always been big, and it will remain big. As long as there are regulations anywhere in the world, compliance consulting, big data analytics consulting, more on the analytics side. Big data is becoming easier and easier and easier. Technology is getting better and better and better. But what do you do when you get all this gigantic blob of data? How do you parse through it? How do you get information that's useful? That's where the biggest challenges are. And this has created, the access of the data has created what I call a data wall. There's just so much that's happening so quickly that companies are paralyzed in the face of all this data. They don't know what to do. And they spend so much time trying to figure out what to do, they actually stop thinking about what to do. And it literally paralyzes them. So they need good consultants, whether you're an independent, as part of the gig economy that we're talking about, or part of a big firm. They need people to help them think through all these issues. What do you do with this stuff? And how much data is too much? Because I really think we've reached a saturation point. And we see a lot of successes in AI, right? Artificial intelligence and IA, right? And IA isn't simply intelligent automation, but it's more of an informatics analytics. You can think of it that way. And if you have intelligent automation, that can take this big blob of stuff, parse it down into manageable chunks of things that you can, and then it can start to categorize and use these heuristic programs to categorize things. And they say, okay, now I can figure out what to do. Now I can start to connect the dots, because I couldn't even see the dots before. Right now I can start to connect them. So that's really big. And more people are needed there. And this says, non-consulting firms alliances. So you start to see in a lot of business areas the need to bring in consulting services and non-consulting services to create sort of a new body or a new form of consulting. So these things are going to be growing in the future. What's spurring growth? You can read from this one. There's a few things that are there. The future of consulting, healthcare, we talked about it, analytics. Multi-sourcing is open source collaboration consulting. It's bringing all these pieces things together, which may or may not be traditionally called consulting, to create this new body of something, which is really, it's just, consulting is morphing into something bigger than what it was, and it's a true case of 1 + 1 = 3. And I don't know how you teach this stuff on a regular basis, because it changes on a, second.
Yeah. We have to update it every semester. Yeah. Everything changes.
And this is cool. This is really neat, because this is something that I've been thinking about this for some time now, probably even before I even knew about Uber. And it was probably more just sort of like in the cloud of my head, right? It's just, like nightmare scenarios. But I actually started to think about it when Jeff Bezos bought the Washington Post. And it really hit me. Was it earlier this year, late last year, when he finalized the deal to buy Whole Foods, right? So he's changed retail through Amazon by basically devaluing the whole brick and mortar business model. So he changed that through restructured business model. He wants to change media and communications through what he wants to do with the Washington Post and a few other media purchases that he's doing. He wants to change the grocery market, food market, and tie it directly into Amazon services. And I wonder what's next. Now, he did announce about a month and a half ago that he wants to get into pharmaceutical business.
Oh, wow.
And I suspect it is not to make drugs or to do the research, though he's dabbling in that. I think it's pharmacies. I think he wants to be like Rite Aid, CVS. I can tell you Walmart is spending a friggin' fortune because they want to be the next big box pharmacy, retail pharmacy. That they will start within all Walmart stores. We'll give it a name, start it within Walmart stores, and then they'll branch it out, which is what they did with Sam's Club. It's part of Walmart. You know, the big box within the big box reached a measure of success, and then they pushed it out. They spun it out to independent business. So there is something to that. But I'm thinking, if Amazon, what could be next? Could you do the business model change thing to consult them? And this was the only thing that I could think of. So I have some friends on Wall Street, and I, you know, these people invest money in all these things. And I said, did anyone ever come up to you with this kind of idea? I'm curious to know what they would talk to you about and how they would structure. No, let's talk about it. Because they were hoping I could tell them, and then they would cut me out of it like a typical Wall Streeter. But what my idea was, and it turns out that this was already going on, was to basically do Uber, right? So why do you know, how does Uber work? You're at the street corner, you type in on your phone, pick me up from here, take me there. And the fee for that ride is already based on a fee schedule that's built into the algorithm. The algorithm decides who's closest to send a call out to the five or six cars that are there. And then those people in the cars can decide, I want to pick up this person. Or they have a rating of 1 star, and go, I don't want to pick up this person. Right? Or a rating of 5 stars, 6, you know, good tipper, I do want to pick up this person. Right? And then they decide, they think, so can you do this with consulting? So think about it. You can set it up where you have independent consultants with definitive skill sets, and you take your skill set or your CV or your whatever, you put it into this database that's controlled by somewhere, somehow, at some point. And it reads keywords in your CV to know what you're good at. But by putting your name into that database, you've agreed to the terms and conditions, which says, you know, I will charge $400 an hour, or whatever the number is. And, you know, the liability for doing poor service or whatever is part of the condition of whoever is on the service side. I want a consultant who can do this to help me solve this problem. So a big company would log into the system and say, here's my problem. The algorithm would figure out what they really mean, sort of like chop it into bits, figure out what they mean, and say, you know, okay, we'd send a message out to 6 consultants in the area or nearby, or consulting could be anywhere in the world, who have the skill set to solve this. And then maybe it's first come, first serve. Whichever consultant grabs it first sends the message directly out to the company. Or maybe 5 resumes go out to the company, and the company can decide, I want this person, or this person, and this person, and this person, and we'll chop up the job, the 1-year job, into 3 bits, or 4 bits, or whatever. As soon as they push the accept button, all the terms and conditions that have already been done and built in, it's agreed to. So there's no contract, because you've accepted the fact, you know, it's the limitation, or it's a liability, it's accept fees. There's no negotiating on fees. Because if you are picking up this person from this system, you're accepting this fee schedule. And if you are a consultant, you're accepting the fee schedule to get paid. So that's the concept of this Uberization. And it's part of the gig economy. So the gig economy is the fancy new word for independent consulting. No matter what else it is, it's independent consulting. Single consulting, or 2 people that want to work together, or small groups, less than 10 people perhaps. I don't know if there's a number, but it's assignment by assignment consulting. And the difference between old independent consulting, and by old I mean last year, 2 years ago, I don't think there's that much of a difference, and the quote new gig economy types of consulting, comes really down to the nature of the assignments, the ease in which people get the assignments. Because in the past, if you were an independent consultant, you would work really hard for 6 months. Work to get a really good job for 6 months, and you work really hard on that job. And because you're working so hard on that job, you don't have the time to go and sell the next one. So frequently, consultants have worked for 6 months, and then they're down for a couple of months until they got the next big job. And then they can work the next, because again, you're working. You don't have time to go and sell. Selling's a lot of work. So, you know, you run this true roller coaster. Cash flow is just, you gotta even have something. Well, that gets, you know, the gig economy and Uber gets rid of all that. You got an algorithm basically set for you. And you're moving things along. So that's a major difference. The other major difference is in the price and the fees. Because independence, as an independent, you're not part of a corporation, your cost of benefits. That means you're on your own. Healthcare, you're paying for healthcare out of your pocket. You're paying the highest rates because it's just you, right? As opposed to in a big company where it's subsidized because there's thousands of them in this thing, or What you see now in the gig economy is people are taking the costs of the benefits that they want and building it into the fee structure. So the difference between this and this is in fees, and it's in structure, and it's in independence. In both cases, though, the time on the roller coaster is really smoothed out quite a bit because your time to go from job to job is minimized. Unless, of course, you want this. You know, there are people that want this. Man, I work so hard, I work these crazy hours. I just want to take it easy for a couple of months, and I'll do sales, and I'll return sales phone calls and do business development. But, you know, I'm not anxious to get into the roller coaster. Bottom line is, when you're an independent consultant, you have that control over your life. You don't have that control over your life if you are in a firm. Whether it's a firm of 100 people or it's a firm of 100,000 people, you don't have that control. And if you think as you move up, if you're in a big firm, as you move up the food chain in these big firms, you have more control over your life, you probably have more control over your travel, but you have less control over your life because of the pressures. You're paid a lot more. As you move up the food chain, you're paid a lot more. People want value for the money they're paying. Prove to me you're worth the money that you're paying. And you will be guilted into working harder than you want to work. And I spent a dozen years in the big And I got to tell you, there were times when you were at the trough, the roller coaster, right? You were between assignments, and you were doing the business development thing, and it was a 9-to-5 type of day, and you'd get home, watch the evening news, and I would have these pangs of guilt because I knew that my partners were working until 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock at night, working on weekends, and I was there watching TV. And everybody in my family said, "You're crazy. Why aren't you just breathing? Why aren't you taking advantage of this downtime? You know you're going to be working hard again at some point. Why don't you take it?" And let me tell you, it's really tough. And your partners remind you of this. Your partners will remind you, "I'm working my ass off. How come you're not working that?" So it's a challenge. It's not that pleasant. Okay. Disruptive models. And that's what we're talking about here. The power of, so let's talk about gig consulting, the power of the gig. So there was a really good report that McKinsey did, and it was at the beginning of this year, and I put some of it, and I'm happy to send this around to you. Independent workers make up 20-30% of the working age population in the U.S. 162 million people. That's a big number. So what do you get out of the gig economy? Flexibility, innovation, ownership, shouldering a significant amount of instability, legal and financial uncertainty. Well, you can't have everything, right? But gig consultants are transforming professional services industry. And I don't even think that we even know what gig consulting really, truly is yet or can do yet, because the concept is literally a year old, 2 years old. I don't even think we have any inkling as to what it can be, except it's sort of like independent consulting, but it's different. You spent a lot of years in it.
Yeah, and it's estimated, by the way, guys, that it's going to be, by 2020, a $1 trillion industry. And I think, I haven't seen that number of 162 million, so it makes sense by 2020, that's how big it would be.
Yeah.
That just kind of reinforces that.
Yep. So what's spurring all this on? Well, yeah, the big consulting names. All the big consulting firms are creating these units within the firms that they're trying to brand this sort of gig consulting within the companies themselves. So PwC calls it Talent Exchange. Deloitte has a name. I can't remember the Deloitte name. Accenture has a name for it. IBM, every firm has a name for it. The big technology firms, Cognizant, Infosys, TCS, don't have a name for it yet.
But you have it?
I don't know. Infosys, I don't think Infosys has something like that. Infosys still relies a lot on subcontractors. But I have to tell you, it's a business that I want to get out of fast. Not because I don't like bringing in subcontractors. I can't stand the paperwork at the moment.
Oh, yeah.
The burden of the paperwork is just ridiculous. And the margins that we have to make it profitable for us price us out of even using the subcontractors for these things. Because right now, according to our policy, we can't bring in a sub unless we can get 35% margin, which is equivalent to basically doubling their rates for the client. So you find a good independent consultant with a specific skill set, $200 an hour. And I get it to turn to a client to say that person's $400 an hour. So I got to double to make the margin. I got to double. The client says, well, that's nice. It's nice that you have access to that subject matter expertise. But that's a lot of money because the client knows they can go to this person directly and pay $200 an hour. We need you for it. Because you know they're not stupid, right? So and that's part of the nice thing about this type of gig economy, Uberization of consulting, independent contracting in the age. Because now you got higher wages. And the higher wages themselves help to sort of bring a bit more of a leveling of the volatility that we talked about in the last slide. So it's 1099 tax designation used to bear stigma of, you know, you're cheap, you know, you're hired assassin, low pay, lack of benefits. But now people are saying, how about that? You know, they're taking 40% and adding 40% to the average rate because that gives me they sit down and say, well, these are all the benefits that I want. If I were the big firm, I would want this. And I would want to have at least 60% of my health care paid for, like that happens anymore. And I want a car, like that happens anymore. And access to the candy machine, which never happens, right? The list, you make a one list, right? And then figure out what the costs are annually, and then divide it by 52 weeks, divide it by 40 hours a week, turn that into an hourly cost. And it might be, you know, that means I'm adding an extra $12 an hour to my rate. You know, and they add it. And there it is. Whoop, there it is. So people are doing that now, and the structure of gig consulting allows them to do that.
Michael, we've got about five minutes. But also maybe we can as well open it up, you know, for some questions. Do you guys have any questions about this whole who has heard about this concept of management consulting?
Is there Upwork?
Yeah, Upwork.
That's not algorithm based. That's a platform for the other. That's a problem based.
You can join us, and we have pizza for you. You can wait here for your class. If you
want. Oh, sorry, I just walked in.
No, please have a seat.
And I only brought up the algorithm because that's how Uber works.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
There's a great article a few years back in the Wall Street Journal. What if your boss is an algorithm? Yeah, and it's really talking about Uber drivers. But Catalent is a company, Boston-based Catalent, started by a couple of Harvard Business School MBAs. They put it together as their paper, and basically it's without the algorithm. It's what I talked about, but without the algorithm. And it's been very successful. And they are used frequently in my industry by Johnson & Johnson and Pfizer. And I suspect they've had good results. I haven't asked anybody from J&J or Pfizer if they like the results. But Catalent's one of them. There's two others, and I can't remember the names of them. But it's brand new. And again, we haven't even touched the surface to how to figure out what this is going to be. And it's going to be big. You can talk about the trillions. I believe it, and I think it's going to happen real fast. Yes?
Don't you think? Even though this gig economy is getting really big, but for a medium to large firm, they will have reservations regarding the quality assurance of the work or maybe the security of the data that is being given out to work on?
Yes.
Because if I give out a contract to PwC or any big firm, I can rest assured that the work...
You cannot rest assured. You can only rest assured that you've got liability insurance.
Yes.
But the biggest data breaches come in results that come out of big firms. The biggest data breaches that have happened in U.S. business, global business, the last 5 years are not the result of independent contractors or smaller contractors or smaller firms. They're always the result of work done by the big firms.
Yeah,
and it's not malevolent. You know, it's not malevolent.
Yeah.
Well, theoretically.
But right. It does happen.
But it does happen. So yeah. But you can. I mean, you get insurance. I minimize it, but you get liability insurance. You were never. Companies don't buy you because you got a pretty face, which means you know you're out of luck, right? So they buy you because you got a track record.
Yeah.
You're smart, and they buy you because of value. So you got to bring something to the table. You can't look like the next guy. Because when you look like the next guy, then it becomes eeny, meeny, miny, moe. Or who's going to give me the cheapest price? And then if they're doing the cheapest price thing, everything that you deliver, even if it's the best in the world, it's devalued because you're the cheapest guy.
Yeah.
So respect your individuality, right? Respect your price. Don't devalue yourself before you had a chance to go in there and prove yourself. But don't go after every job that's out there. Go after jobs that you're comfortable doing because you're bringing something to the table.
Yeah, these platforms, they have rankings. Like I just hired a consultant for my nonprofit, and it shows how much they raised. So this person generated $40,000 over 2 years.
Yep.
They had 97% completion rate. I get much more confident hiring them than, the big four has a reputation, but I have no idea what that individual on the other end of that, how they've had success. Are they brand new? Are they 1 year out of college? So.
Yep. So big four gives you big. Period.
I'm in my previous company, I worked with one of the big firms.
Yeah.
People that descended, honestly, are really interns which have no idea what they do, to be honest.
Yeah.
And whereas if you hire someone, let's say Upwork,
yeah,
you have a track record that you can look into.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
I was just curious, like, companies like Cadillac, they go into business, how are they marketing themselves, and how are they, because it's such a large part of the economy, how are people finding these independent firms which are not as big as other companies?
Well, you know what Cadillac's and the others are doing, and honestly, a lot of it's probably word of mouth. I found out about Cadillac through Forbes. There was an article in Forbes, and I think about 4 months ago, Boston Globe, a big story about Game Changers. I think they called it was Game Changers,
yep.
Boston area, right? And this was the highlighted one there. And as I said, I didn't know about it. To me, this was an idea I had. I was talking to my Wall Street friends. They're saying, we want to do it. And little did I know this was going on. In a little bit of research, it's there. So that's how they found out. The guys at Pfizer found out about Cadillac through a friend of a friend of a friend. Word of mouth. There's nothing wrong with that.
I think we have time for maybe just one more question, and
so
then we'll have
to
wrap.
This is not a question, but I'm aware that IITs in India have something similar running, and they have similar services offered across India as well as on international platform, predominantly in IT and ITBS.
Yes.
And machine learning and artificial AI sectors.
Yes.
Yep.
Yes. But what is being offered in India and the services that are coming, it's the market has to, they have to change their demeanor. What I've found, and I do not mean this in a negative way, because I'm working in a big Indian firm, and I was at TCS before that, which is another huge, they run India, basically.
Yeah.
Culturally, very humble about what they do, and they're not really good at self-promotion. So TCS, for example, was doing genetic engineering data analysis before the guys in Baltimore. Nobody knew about it, right? And it's a shame because they were really on the bleeding edge. And you find that in IT, you find it in consulting, and you find it in AI. Now, it's just now the word's starting to get out. People are starting to spread their wings and say, have capabilities. So it will work, but it's all word of mouth. They have to get the word out.
I think we're out of time, so thank you everyone for joining us.